our series on Galatians. And man, Kelly did such a great job last weekend, and I heard the message. But this is such a pivotal letter that Paul wrote. I mean, it's going to make a huge impact up to this day. So I'm really excited about continuing that. So I'm going to read the passage. It's from Galatians chapter 2, verse 11 through 14. And if you forget anything from tonight's message, you'll at least have the text. So I'm going to read that right now. So here it goes. It says, when Cephas, and that's referring to Peter. Cephas was Aramaic, translated to Petros in Greek, and Peter in English. So when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of them all, this is Paul saying this, you're a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? I want to just start out by just asking you a question, taking a little poll here, but how many of you love confrontation? Raise your hand. How many of you love confrontation? Okay, we have one back there, bold person, two. You love confronting someone, three? Okay, so that's a minority here. How many of you hate confronting people like a plague? All right, so majority of you here do not like confrontation, right? We can agree with that. I do not like confrontation at all. I avoid it like the plague. I've read so many books about how to have these crucial conversations, difficult conversations and confrontations with people in a healthy way. But it's just really hard because I have this people-pleasing side to me. And I think majority of us don't love confrontation. You know, I remember time when I was a young adult, in my previous ministry years, I was going to this other church, and I remember we used to have these like monthly leadership gatherings. So it was about 40 or 50 of our core group leaders, ministry leaders. We would get together once a month and hear a talk, much like what we're doing here, but it was more like leadership. And I remember one of the leaders, a senior leaders, she gave a talk, and she was highly influential. She was just super sharp, super like articulate, just a brilliant like communicator teacher. She was actually a professor, a sociology professor at prestigious universities as well too. And so she gave this talk where she was kind of talking about her research that she was doing, where when you look back at the history of churches and church buildings, even geographically, they were in the center of a village or a city or community. And people came to not only have their spiritual needs met, but their financial, economic needs, or relational, communal needs as well, too. And so people were connected, and they were committed to that local faith community, much like, just like today's time. And so I was jiving with that. I understood that. But then this talk continued on, and she was talking about how high school students, we had some high school students, college students, many of you are college students, young adults should make life decisions or live their lives about who to marry or what school to go to or what grad school or what work they should have based on that church that they were going to at that time. It went further by her sharing that she would send her kids, who were in middle school and elementary at that time, to a local college around the community so that they can go to that church. Now, maybe this doesn't sound like anything terrible or anything like that at all, but something didn't feel right in my spirit. You know, because I think it could feel like control or manipulation, because I knew that She wasn't going to send her kids to a local college. And some of the young adults in the room, you could kind of tell they were getting a little tense and a little uncomfortable too, because it's one thing if you choose, like, I would love for all of you, and I'm sure Kelly as well too, if you guys chose to stay locally here for your work or for your grad school or college, all those things. It's one thing if your own choice, like Dean, Viola, right? You're kind of here at the same. But it's another thing to say we can only be here. You know, because God is a big God, right? He's a big God, and he could use us in the different cities, different workplaces, different grad schools to share his gospel. And so there was a Q&A time at the end, and I really wanted to say something. I didn't know exactly what to say, but I wanted to speak up and say something. But I was thinking, who am I? I was just this young leader, fresh out of seminary. I didn't hold the professional credentials or degree or the influence that this person had. And to be honest, I was just afraid. I was afraid of just looking foolish or being dismissed and maybe even just being kicked out of the leadership group or losing my job. And I don't know about you, like maybe you've been in a situation where you felt like something wasn't right in your spirit. You felt like what was said or something was contradicting the gospel, your gospel convictions. And I'm not talking about your personal opinions or your, you know, political leanings or affiliation. I'm not talking about that. And I'm not talking about like the situation with mask wearing and vaccine and all that. I'm talking about a conviction in the gospel truth. Maybe you've had that. And sometimes it's in the face of a lot of pressure or criticism or even just lashback, potential consequences. And this is a tough conversation to enter into, but maybe one example is our response to just the racial tensions that we've experienced or we're still experiencing. And it's really hard because I don't know about you, but it felt like a damned if you do, damned if you don't. Can I say that even here? But yeah, I'm going to say it. Damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. Right? Like no matter what your response was or your lack of response, you're going to be criticized. You're going to be put on one side or another. Actually, you know what? I stopped using social media because I saw such verbal violence happening in social media about a year and a half ago. I didn't want to be put on one side or another. Like I think most of our genuine pursuit and desire in the situation was for the gospel to bring healing and restoration to the racial tension and divisions that we're experiencing. For there to be peace and harmony in the ethnic and racial diversity and harmony in Christ. For there to be pursue justice and compassion and seeking after the Lord. For us to first seek to understand before being understood. For there to be racial reconciliation, that movement toward racial reconciliation through the power of the gospel. I think that's what most Christ followers were hoping for. Although I've seen a lot of division, I've seen a lot of hate as well too, which saddened me. But maybe that's one example, but there's other examples as well too. And there's a time to be quiet. There's a time to be wise, just to wait and listen and learn. But there's also a time where we need to speak up. And I'm not talking about putting on social media. That's easy to do. I'm talking about having that conversation with someone in love. Entering into those hard, difficult conversations, there's a time to speak up and raise your voice and stand firm for the gospel. So this is where the text for today in Galatians 2, 11, 14 will hopefully illuminate what Christ followers should do, what we are to chase after and what we are to avoid, what it means to stand firm for the gospel. So let me just give you some context here of this passage. So Peter comes to town. Peter comes to this bustling city called Antioch. And it's just smaller than those big metropolitan cities, Rome and Alexandria of that time, but it was a big city. And Kellyanne mentioned this last week, but Peter, I mean, he was big time. He was a big time disciple. He had walked with Jesus during Jesus' lifetime. He had seen miracles. He had actually walked on water. He was part of Jesus' inner circle, Peter, James, and John. Peter had preached to thousands of people, and people were coming to know Christ. He was one of the pillars of the church. He was like the Billy Graham, or maybe even bigger, of that time. And Peter comes to Antioch, and he notices that the Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians were hanging out, eating together, without regard to the Jewish dietary laws. You know, if you know that Jews, they had a strict diet, and the Gentiles didn't follow that. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that. But people were hanging out. Jews, Gentiles were hanging out. And so Peter was eating and hanging out and fellowshipping with them on a regular basis. And then this is just a beautiful demonstration of the unity of Jews and Gentiles, Gentile Christian. It's a beautiful thing because there was so much racism at that time, so much prejudice. But this quickly changed when these Jewish folks had come to town and they were outraged and infuriated by Peter's action. Peter's action, yeah. They were outraged by it. And it talks about how they belong to the circumcision party. Once again, I know Kelly had elaborated what circumcision means, so I don't have to go into all of that, but what a terrible name to be given to a group, right? We're the circumcision party, and we are here to snip, snip. I don't know. But they're there. They're called the Judaizers. Also, there's a Jewish conservative group that believed that the Gentiles were off limits, that you shouldn't hang out with them, even though they're Christians, because they were uncircumcised. They didn't follow the kosher dietary habits. They were unkosher, and they didn't abide by the Jewish holy day. So they're off limits. You can't hang out with them. And Peter, remember, he's one of the pillars of the church. He was influenced by their presence. And slowly but surely, he drifted. He kind of drew back, and he separated himself from the Gentile Christians. And by such action, Peter was teaching that there are two bodies of Christ. There's Jews and there's Gentiles. And this was wrong. This was heresy. Justification by faith alone had settled that. This is what Paul says in Galatians 3, and I'll read this. I don't think it's up there. He says, in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. So why did Peter do this? Why did Peter do this? You know, was it because he had a change in his belief or his theology? No. It was because he was afraid. It was just simply out of fear. And at the end of Galatians chapter 2, verse 12, we see that Peter was led by fear, not by the gospel. But fear of what? He wasn't afraid of the Gentiles, the Gentile Christian. He was hanging out with them. He was afraid of his own people, his own ethnic group, these Jewish folks who were stirring up trouble. And maybe he was afraid of conflict. You know, like I said, I don't like conflict. Perhaps he just thought, you know, these Judaizers, these Jewish Christians were going to cause a scene and make things really difficult. So maybe he thought, like, you know, maybe I want to just avoid the scene. And they'll be satisfied. These Judaizers will be satisfied if he stopped hanging out with these Gentile Christians. And maybe they will go home and things will settle back to normal. And Paul is saying that's fearful behavior. That's hypocrisy. That's not acting in line with the truth of the gospel. And maybe the question that the Lord wants to ask us is, is our life led by the fear of conflict, the fear of criticism, the fear of controversy. And we don't know what Peter was exactly afraid of, but what's clear is that Peter's defection, him separating himself from the Gentile Christians, it brought about the defection of other Jewish Christians, and even Barnabas, who was like Paul's right-hand man. Barnabas was in these like missionary journeys and programs with Paul to reach the Gentiles for the gospel. So we know the pressure must have been immense for Barnabas to succumb to this. So Peter, all of them, Peter, Barnabas, these Jewish Christians, they were all guilty of hypocrisy. You know, they were teaching and confessing that they were one in Christ with the Gentiles, but their actions were denying this truth. And the key phrase is in Galatians 2:14, and maybe we could bring that up. Paul says this. He says, "When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, 'You're a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs?'" And do you see what that implies? It implies that there are actions, conduct, behavior, things that we do say that may not be in line, that may not be walking in truth with the gospel. To put it another way, the gospel leads and it governs not just our beliefs, not just our thoughts, but our actions. So there's gospel belief and there's gospel actions. And there are some beliefs that contradict the gospel, and there are some actions that contradict the gospel. And right here in this situation, Peter, Barnabas, the other Jewish Christians, their actions were contradicting the gospel. And so Paul is saying this to Peter. He's saying, "Hey, Pete, you're a Jew, and you don't live like a Jew. How do you expect Gentiles to live like a Jew?" Essentially, he's saying, "Pete, you're a hypocrite. You're a hypocrite." Now, Paul makes it clear in this book of Galatians what the heart of the gospel is. And we don't have to look very far other than verse 15 to 16 to see it. And I know we're going to be covering that. You're going to hear more about it in next week and the subsequent weeks. But I just want to touch upon it because we need to see it holistically. And this was what Paul says. He says, "We who are Jews by birth and not sinful Gentiles." So Paul is addressing the Jewish Christians, including himself. He says, "We know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, because by the works of the law, no one will be justified." See, the heart of the gospel was justification by faith alone, apart from the works of the law. Apart from the works of the law. You know, last week I was on jury duty. How many of you guys have ever been on jury duty before? Several of you? Okay, so you know the drill. So I was actually summoned for jury duty, I should say. I mean, I had so much to do this week, and I don't know what I was thinking, but I thought I was for sure going to be chosen as a jury member. There was about 16 people left, and you know, if you've ever been summoned, the prosecution, the prosecutor, the defense counsel, they start asking the potential jurors a lot of questions, like, "What do you do? What does your wife do? How many children you have?" All that stuff. Like, they just want to know if you can be impartial. The moment I said I was a pastor, they're like, "Okay, we don't want you anymore." I don't know for what reason they don't want pastors on the jury. But I was there for 2 days in the courtroom, and I was thinking a lot about justification, because it's a fancy theological term. But justification is what a judge does in a courtroom. You know, the defendant is declared innocent because he or she is found to have real innocence. And the defendant is declared to be just because he or she is found to be just. I know for some of us, this is something we know. But for us, we can never, never be declared just and righteous and innocent in ourselves. Because we've all sinned. We've all fallen short. We've all missed a mark. We're guilty as charged. We deserve the full penalty, the full sentence of condemnation. And no works of the law, it can't save us. Because we've broken God's law. And so now the law condemns us. So how can we be justified? How can God, the judge, declare us righteous, just, innocent? And that's the good news. That's the gospel. That's what's called the great exchange. The answer is Jesus Christ lived and died to bring righteousness, to provide us righteousness, to pay our debts, to bear our punishment. And it's by trusting in Christ alone that his righteousness is given to us, right? And his death is counted as ours. So faith alone unites us to Christ, not works. Faith alone unites us to Christ. So no work of any kind can connect us to Christ and his righteousness, his atonement. But it's his blood. It's his sacrifice that washed away all of our sins and placed us in that right standing before God. And for his sake alone that God counts us righteous and welcomes and invites us into a relationship with him where we can adore him and delight in him and worship him for all eternity. What a hope, right? What a promise. And that is the heart of the gospel. That's the good news. And the beautiful, wise, kind, serving, caring attitudes and behaviors flow from this gospel. And you read the second half of most of Paul's letters, and you'll see the life in step with the truth of the gospel. That's the gospel. And as Christ followers, as we're living in some crazy times, right? We're living in some really uncertain times. You know, there are a couple questions that we can ask ourselves so that we can live faithfully, that we can live aligned with the truth of the gospel. And I think the first question is, are we walking in step? Are we walking in step with the truth of the gospel? When you look at your actions, when you look at your behavior, when you look at the things you do and say, is it in line with the gospel? Or does it contradict the gospel? Is it the kind of action that would flow from walking with Jesus, from knowing Jesus? Is it, you know, does our action say true things about the gospel? The things that I was talking about for the past 10 minutes. You know, the best analogy, maybe it's not the best analogy, but something that I thought of is like that I can give about this is that some of these new cars that you have, they have this advanced technology called auto steer or auto drive. How many of you guys heard about that? It's pretty wild, okay? And the way that it works is there's cameras. It uses cameras to track the lane lines. And then the car steers. It drives automatically and keeps the car centered in the lane. Pretty wild. I can't believe. Pretty soon we'll have fully auto-driving cars. I guess where the analogy breaks down is walking in step with the truth of the gospel, it doesn't come automatic. We have to do our own steering. But the picture is that the lane is the gospel. And when our actions or other people's actions start to drift or veer away from the lane, we know what it takes to get back, to the get back on the track and get centered on the lane. We know what it looks like. And rather than pointing the finger at other people, we need to first look within our own hearts, our own actions. I think sometimes we, like Christ followers, we get a bad rep because we're just criticizing and judging and rebuking and pointing the finger at other people. We need to first look within our own hearts and see if we've drifted off course. And if you're a Christ follower, we can ask the Holy Spirit to search us and examine our hearts. You know, are there actions that demonstrate bias and prejudice, racism toward people that are different from us? And that hurts the harmony and peace that the gospel proclaims. And that's a hard thing to admit for some Christ followers, that we have prejudice and racism in our hearts. And without repentance and confession, there can't be transformation and change. You know, do we sometimes dilute and compromise the gospel because of the pressures of our society? And the pressures are real. Or the temptations that we face when it comes to relationships and dating and sex, when the scriptures make it so clear that sex belongs in marriage between one man and one woman. But our society says, no, everyone's doing it. Why can't we? You know, do we struggle sometimes with legalism and pride? Because we grew up in the church and we know the Bible. And so we think our sins are not as bad as those other people's sins. Or that we can somehow behave or perform to earn God's love and grace. When we talked about it, we've all sinned and fallen short of God's glory. Paul says in Ephesians 2:8, familiar passage, for it's by grace that we've been saved through faith. It's the gift of God. It's not by our works, so that no one can boast. Again, we need to first look within our own hearts. Are we walking in step with the truth of the gospel? I think the second question that we can ask ourselves is, can we distinguish the false gospels from the real thing? You know, there have been false gospels for centuries. And, you know, Kelly once again mentioned some of the ones that we have in today's time. But it has led many people astray. Even though they have a form of Christianity, it's not the real thing. And I think it's helpful for us to know, you know, I'm not going to name just all the list of major false gospels, but it's helpful to know that the false gospels kind of land within one of two categories. One, the first one is what I call the watered-down gospel, and I'll just kind of quickly talk about this. But this is the gospel that offers God's forgiveness, that tells you that all you need to do is believe, but without any mention of repentance. You know, it presents Jesus as though he were just a mere addition to make your life a little bit better, when Jesus is our all in all. He is above all. He's the one who holds all things together. The watered-down gospel, it tells you about heaven, but it leaves out any talk about hell. Talks about prosperity and blessings in following Christ, but it doesn't talk about faith through the trials and struggles and challenges. So the watered-down gospel. The second category is what I call the rule-based, overly complex gospel. That was a very complex even category there. But this gospel, it just strips the true gospel of its simplicity and its power. It's weighed down with a bunch of rules and regulations that you have to keep to find forgiveness. And it's so complex that no one can unravel it. And friends, like, I've known people that say they're Christians. You know, I don't know about you, but I've had Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormon kids come to my door. And my wife always wants me to be like, shoo them away. Come on, just go away. Just okay. It's okay. Like, we got it. We're Christians. I always love to invite them in. I invite them in. I offer them coffee, cookies. Actually, they don't drink coffee or soda or Mormons and stuff. But I just want to have a conversation with them. And it sounds like a form of Christianity, but it isn't. And it's so easy to drift. You know, it's like when you don't have wheel alignment in your car, you start to slowly drift. And if we can differentiate the false gospels from the real thing, we're able to better defend the gospel. We're able to help others being derailed or going off course. Because it's not about being a jerk and being like, you are a cult. You know, you are not a Christian. You're the devil. No, you're not going to do that. You know, we don't want to be jerks about it. We can speak the truth in love, in conversation, in dialogue, lovingly bring them back to the gospel truth. We've been through a lot, right? I said we've been through a lot over the past 2 years. Dre, one of our teaching pastors, says like COVID started, the world ended type of thing. We've been through a lot. We've gone, you know, we've had to navigate through a global pandemic. Seen an economic collapse. We've seen nationwide uprisings for racial injustice. We've seen a contentious political election. We've been through a lot. Most of you are in your 20s. I'm in my 40s. But in your lifetime, you will go through other challenges and trials and struggles. You will. Whether it's in your personal life, or whether what's happening in our society. But I want to encourage you, no matter what you go through, fall in love with the gospel. Fall in love with Jesus. Don't fall in love with politics. Gosh, there's so many people just in love with politics. Fox News or MSNBC or Trump or Obama. Who's our current president right now? Biden. I just had a brain fart. That's not recorded, is it? Don't fall in love with politics. Don't fall in love with your career. Don't fall in love with a person. Don't fall in love with yourself. Some people are so in love with themselves. My son is in love. He's 15. He's in love with himself right now. So prideful and insecure at the same time. I don't get these teenagers. Don't fall in love with religion or works. Fall in love with Jesus. Fall in love with the gospel. And really the bottom line, you know, right? That's beautiful. Thanks, Kaylee. Like when you fall in love with Jesus, when you fall in love with the gospel truth, you'll stand firm in your faith. You'll stand firm in your convictions. I love my wife. We've been married for 18 years. No, we're going to be 18, November 15th. I didn't forget. Yes, thank you. Although we got into a big fight last week, but, you know, married couples. You get into arguments, but we love each other. I love her so much. I'm madly in love with her. And I will do anything to protect her and shield her from harm. If someone tries to harm her, you know what I would do? Oh, that's what I would do. I don't know. Don't mess with her. Because I'm in love with her. I will stand firm for my wife. If you fall in love with Jesus, if you fall in love with the gospel, you will stand firm in your faith. You know, coming back to the story I started with of being a young leader and hearing that talk. And, you know, there's some other things that were mentioned, and I'm not going to go into all of that stuff. But I knew that it was contradicting the gospel. I knew that something just was not right, where it was more about the church rather than Jesus and the gospel. And so like I said, there was a Q&A time, and I did say something. I don't even remember what I said. I was so scared because no one else was saying anything, right? I was like, how come no one's saying anything? And I was one of the leaders and the pastors there, and I had to say something, and I did, and it was just so inarticulate. I couldn't really, I wasn't very bold in what I was saying. And, you know, I know it's so small in comparison to so many of the courageous men and women who have stood firm for the gospel, even in the face of, like, persecution and threat, danger, even death. But I spoke up, you know, sheepishly. It didn't go so well. It's not always going to go well. It didn't get received so positively. In fact, it led to me transitioning out of a ministry that I was part of for 16 years. So it was really hard. You know, sometimes speaking up requires sacrifice. Now, I'm not saying, that's not encouragement for you to challenge everything that Kelly says here and stuff, or what the Rocky Peak leadership says. That's not what I'm saying. But none of us are immune to straying from the gospel. Do you know that? None of us are to going astray. And if you have a firm gospel conviction to speak up for something that you see as contradicting the gospel, then by all means, do so. Do so. Be courageous. Speak up. Because while we submit to the leadership here on earth, our first allegiance, our primary allegiance is to Christ and living in the truth of the gospel. And let me close with this. Maybe I went a little too long. You know, we know from the text what Paul says and how Paul confronts and rebukes and challenges and opposes Peter, right? But we don't know what Peter's response was. It doesn't say. Like, was he angry? Was he defensive? Was he sad? Did he realize the error of his ways? Did he feel convicted? It doesn't say. I'm like, oh, it just puts me on a cliffhanger there. Well, in Galatians, it doesn't really say, but when we read the book of Acts, which is a good complementary, like, historical account of Paul's missionary journeys, we see an event, a pivotal event that happened in 50 AD. And most scholars say it happened after Galatians was written. A pivotal event called the Jerusalem Council. And I'm not going to go into all the details on that, but it was an event where all these church leaders came to settle what are the requirements to be a Christ follower, the basic requirements to be a Christ follower, and settle the issue of the circumcision nonsense. And I want to read what Peter says in Acts 15, verse 7 through 11. Remember, this is the same Peter who was rebuked by Paul. Peter says this. He says, after much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He didn't discriminate between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of Gentiles a yoke that neither we nor ancestors have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are. Peter was brought back to the gospel truth. And imagine if Paul didn't have the courage to stand up in this tide that was coming to the Galatian Christians. He could have been afraid. He could have just been timid, but he spoke up. And so, friends, my hope and prayer is this, that you would fall in love with the gospel, with the gospel truth, so that you can stand firm in the faith when that time comes, that you can say, I am crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. That you can say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. First for the Jew, then for the Gentile. That you can say, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Fall in love with the gospel and you will stand firm in the faith. So let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you for what you did on the cross. Thank you that we have a relationship with you. Thank you that you give us the good news, the gospel truth, so that when we are drifting, that you can bring us back to that centered lane. And when we see others veering off, that we can lovingly but courageously bring them back to the gospel. So Lord, would you help us to be strong in the faith, to not bow to idols, to not bow to the pressures of our society, to not bow to the world standards of things, but that we can look to you as our North Star, God. Thank you, God. May you be magnified. May you be glorified in us and through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.